last week we were in 2 Samuel 7, and we didn't finish up the Davidic covenant because there's just so much there and so much of what it's tying together from the other biblical covenants. And the Davidic covenant, as I said, kind of pulls all the covenants together. I thought of it kind of like when you're plugging in your computer cords into that one power strip and you plug that other power strip into the wall, that if that one's not plugged into the wall, well, nothing else is going to work in a sense. And, you know, it's not a perfect analogy. But the Davidic covenant is really a high point of the Old Testament and really the whole Bible, because all the other covenants kind of meet in this one. And if the Davidic covenant is accomplished, which God promises, then all the other covenants are accomplished in that. And so we see that even the Noahic covenant, the rest and the peace from that, the Abrahamic covenant, the promise of for Israel and for the world of the land, the seed, the blessing, the nation, and then being a blessing to all the families of the earth, all the nations of the earth. And the Davidic covenant incorporates that. It says that David will be, you know, I'm going to make you a great name, and he borrows that language from Genesis 12. And then the law covenant, the covenant of it's sometimes called the Mosaic covenant or the Sinaitic covenant, that Israel's obedience to the law in the land will either, or lack thereof, will either bring blessing or curse, and the Davidic king is going to be kind of responsible for reading the law, for writing down a copy of the law, and for administering the law. So kind of what we're meant to see here is, you know, as the king goes, so Israel goes, and as Israel goes, so the world goes. And so this all stands or falls with the Davidic covenant. And just to remind us of the things that the Davidic covenant promises before we pick up where we left off, I made a list, and we got through about half of them, but we talked about the Davidic covenant promises a place for Israel. It promises, you know, David as this example and his great name and all that, but it also promises for Israel. So David gets promised a great name. Israel gets promised a place and a land. They get promised rest, which we will talk about more, but that idea of not only rest politically from enemies, but rest in a more creational sense, an Edenic sense, the sense of that God is restoring the blessedness of creation, that things like the Sabbath laws and things like that were meant to point to, that the perfection of creation had not been lost. He promises David a house. David says, I want to build you a house, and God says, that's not going to happen, but I'm going to build you a house, David, and sets that up for him. So that's made the priority. The kingdom and David's house is set up before Solomon can come and be that temple builder and build God's house. He's also promised a seed. He's promised a son to follow after him, which is, we'll see how that applies as well. He's promised an enduring kingdom, that his son will be the temple builder. The dynasty is promised an eternal throne and an eternal kingdom. The Davidic son is promised sonship to in relationship to God as the father. And he's seen in this kind of adoption language that the man, the Davidic king, will act as the son of God, the son of the Lord. And then he's also promised discipline if he sins. But also there's this connection in there of suffering for sin if need be. And then what makes David different from Saul is not David just in and of himself, but what makes David different from Saul is the Lord says, I've selected you, and I'm not going to reject you the way that I've rejected Saul. My loyal love will, my loving kindness, my steadfast love will not depart from you as it departed from Saul. I'm going to set this up forever and continually. So this is something that cannot be taken away from David, from the Davidic kingdom, the Davidic house. And so we've seen that. So we saw last week, we talked about that up until we talked through the land. And we'll talk about rest again this morning. But let me read again 2 Samuel, starting in chapter 7, starting in verse 8. And let me just read through the promises of the Davidic covenant so we hear this again and hear these truths again and can kind of work our minds around these things. So starting in verse 8, this is Nathan speaking to David, or the Lord speaking to David through Nathan. It says, "Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make you a great name, like all the names of the great men who are on the earth. I will also appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may live in their own place and not be disturbed again. Nor will the wicked afflict them any more as formerly, even from the day I commanded the judges to be over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. I will give the Lord also declares that the Lord will make a house for you. When your days are complete and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your seed after you, who will come forth from you. And I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he will be a son to me. When he commits iniquity, I will correct him with the rod of men and the strokes of the son of men. But my loving kindness shall not depart from him as I took it away from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and your kingdom shall endure before me forever. Your throne shall be established forever." In accordance with all of these words and all this vision, so Nathan spoke to David. So there's a lot there. And obviously, I think it's good to have, you know, at times just an extended reading of the text and going over and just hearing all that's there. And in David, after this, it says that he goes and, you know, he sat before the Lord, probably before the ark, and he's kind of just in awe, and he prays this prayer of praise to God, and he's just like, basically, what just happened? Wow, this is, you know, I had a plan to do something good, you know, in my intentions, but God says, no, I'm going to give you this huge thing. And David says that, you know, Lord, this was insignificant for you to do this to me, but this is a huge deal. This is something that is worldwide in its significance and scope. This is something that's going to have a universal impact. And he says this isn't just for Israel. If you look ahead at 7, I think it's 19, he says that's a difficult verse to translate. Different translations have different things, but basically what he's saying is this is the charter for the nations. This is the law for the nations, or the custom for the nations of man. This is something that's going to not only impact me and impact Israel, it's going to impact everyone. And you see the connection there between Abraham. All the nations will be blessed in you. And so we saw that last week. So we saw where we left off last week. We were talking about the land, that Israel would be planted in the land, that they would be, that the Davidic covenant terminates the period of the judges. I was having a discussion online on a group that I belong to on Facebook. We were talking about different things. And they were talking about, this just shows the importance of understanding the intention of, you know, Scripture and the biblical books. Because this person I was talking to is a brother. It's not somebody, you know, any of you guys know. But he was saying, you know, the period of the judges is a good example of how government worked in Israel during this time. And I'm like, Yeah, well, the problem with that is the period of the judges is the worst time in Israel's history. It's not, I get where you're saying, you know, the laws of Deuteronomy and the theocracy there that, you know, that yes, that you know, should have had it been obeyed, would have been a good, you know, some lessons could have been drawn there and principles there for government and different things. He said, but you don't want to use the period of judges as an example for things. I said, that's the darkest time in Israel's history. That's a time of where things are so chaotic because everyone's doing what's right in their own eyes, and there's no king to end that period. And, you know, we went back and forth a little bit discussing that. And he's like, well, that's not the way I see it. I don't see judges. I'm like, but that's what the intention of the book is. It doesn't matter how you see it. That's what it says. I said, and then I pointed out to 2 Samuel 7:11. I said, I'm going to cause a king to rule over you, unlike the days of the judges. So he didn't concede the point, but, you know, we're continuing to have that discussion. But the point is here that the unrest that's happening in the period of judges is brought to an end by the Davidic covenant. And so let's look at, so that was, and Israel is going to be planted in the land. That's what we looked at last time. That's a fulfillment of the words to Abraham in Genesis 15, that they would have this certain territory of boundaries, which Israel has yet to possess. They have not possessed from the river Euphrates to, you know, this other borderline, and they will. And Deuteronomy promises the same thing in the Mosaic covenant, and he says that you're going to blot out Amalek from the land, and you're going to possess between these borders, and you're going to be given rest. And so now both of those covenants are brought into the Davidic covenant. It says now you're going to have rest from your enemies. So let's look into that a little bit further. In second, that's in verse 11, and I will give you rest from your enemies. Last week I talked about this because the beginning of 2 Samuel 7 starts with this context. It says, now it came about when the king lived in his house that the Lord had given him rest on every side from his enemies. So this is the idea, not just of, as I said, political rest and military rest, but what the word is hinting at here and what the author of Scripture is hinting at here is that there is a larger concept of rest that's going to come to rest, that's, no pun intended, that's going to come to rely on the Davidic covenant. That if the Davidic covenant is fulfilled by the king, that it's going to not only bring this political and military rest from enemies, but that it's going to be a mechanism where God is going to reverse the curse and bring back the rest that is in the original creation. Or day seven, that God rested. That, you know, how many days did God, you know, you can ask this a trick question in Sunday school, how many days did God create the earth in? And people sometimes say seven, and you say wrong, it's six. And then and so I've joked with some people, science teachers who are unbelievers at school. They said, you really believe God created the world in 7 days? And I said, no, I believe that God created the world in 6 days, and on the seventh he rested. And it led to some discussion from there. But anyway, that rest, remember that man and woman are there in that rest on that seventh day, and that's what is lost in a sense in the fall. And Noah is seen as a hope for that. Maybe Noah's the new one. Maybe he's the second Adam that's going to crush the head of the serpent. And his father, Lamech, says, names him Noah, which means rest. And he said, okay, well, maybe this is the one in Genesis 5:29 who will give us rest, who will restore rest. And then the flood happens. So Noah kind of is that one, but not in an ultimate sense, because that's not what's happening there. And then in another sense, remember that after 40 years of wandering into the wilderness, Psalm 95 talks about that apostate generation, that unbelieving generation. And Psalm 95, God is speaking in that psalm and says, they refuse to enter my rest, and it's because they refuse because of unbelief. And he says, and therefore I swore in my anger, they will not enter my rest. In Psalm 95:11, they are not going to get to enter into the land that is tied with that creational rest, the potential for returning in a sense to what had been lost in Eden. They're not going to enter it. Only two people, Joshua and Caleb, of that whole generation, go into the land. And so the next generation who goes in with Joshua. But even still, Joshua in the conquest is not able to bring about that total rest, that perfect rest, that the perfection of that rest. And that's going to be accomplished in the Davidic covenant. I will give you rest from all your enemies. And so that is taken. We need to understand, I think, sometimes our identity and role as the church, and also, you know, what Israel's role is in the economy and the plan of God. Because we hear rest, and we think in the spiritual sense, which is true, that we enter into Christ into spiritual rest. That's absolutely true. We rest in Christ. Come, you who are weary laden, and I will give you rest. So that is in a spiritual sense, but also we need to remember that God's plan and God's kingdom is going to be worked out in a real way on this earth. That there's going to be a real rest, that it's going to be tied with Israel accomplishing these things in the world through the Davidic king, and that it's going to mean, you know, real things in this physical world. So just to keep that in mind as well, it's a both and type of statement. For the church, it's a spiritual reality, but we ought to keep in mind the physical reality that will that is coming about, that is going to be accomplished here. And this is what the author of Hebrews picks up on in Hebrews 3:4. He's talking about, you know, be careful in case you come short of that rest, that because of unbelief, because of shrinking back from the truth of the gospel, because of trying to leave the gospel and go back to Judaism. There's nothing to go back to, is the message of Hebrews, and saying, look, don't be like that generation who refused to go into the land, and that God swore it to them in Psalm 95 and says, I swore in my anger, they will not enter my rest. And he said, look, that rest wasn't accomplished with the old covenant. It was promised in the Davidic covenant. He goes, that rest was not accomplished at that time. He goes, if Joshua, remember the Greek name of Joshua is Jesus, so it's kind of, I think, kind of a play on words there. So if Joshua had given them rest, the first Joshua, Jesus, if he had given them true rest in the land, well, God would have never had to speak again. It would have been done and over with. The world would have been returned to its perfection. Everybody, you know, the nations would have been blessed. Everything would have been accomplished. But we know that the book of Joshua is not the end of the Bible. And it's not the end of history in the world. And it says, so what is being brought in here in Hebrews is he's saying that Christ has accomplished these things, that Christ has brought final rest, that he has brought that true rest for God's people. And the author of Hebrews is warning, don't fall short of that by unbelief, by shrinking back in a sense. And so what all that's going to be accomplished, again, through the Davidic covenant. The king is going to have to bring together that rest, or he's promised that rest by God. And just to look ahead a little bit, this isn't even fully accomplished by David. Even though the covenant is made to him and to his house, it's made in a long-term way that eventually through this promise, David's not going to be the one, but in this promise to David, that's how everything's going to be accomplished. Let me read Isaiah 11:10, looking ahead to the son of David. This is long after, you know, this is after David. Isaiah 11:10 says, then in that day, and speaking about, it's about to talk about new heavens and new earth, all that, says, then in that day the nations will resort to the root of Jesse, meaning the true David, the one who's the better David, who will stand as a signal for the peoples, and his resting place will be glorious. So it's talking about that the son of David, that in fulfilling this covenant, is going to bring ultimate rest. And that's what's being accomplished here, this root of Jesse. So that's Davidic covenant language. And it's not just for Israel. It says for the nations, the Gentiles, are going to resort. They're going to turn toward this Davidic king. And they're going to worship him. And that he's going to bring rest throughout the whole earth. And we are in a unique place as a church. We represent that. You know, we're kind of in an in-between time where we're showing that that's still coming. We're showing that both to Israel and to the world. And so we have that relationship to Christ now as the church. But also, the next thing is promised in chapter 7, verse 11. The Lord also declares to you that the Lord will make a house for you. Remember, this is in the context of the ark in chapter 6 being moved into Jerusalem, and it's in a tent, which God had always been in a tent, dwelling with his people who lived in tents during the wilderness wanderings. Now David has taken over Jerusalem, this new capital and the central place of worship. Now the ark is been brought there, and so it's not only a military political conquest. Now you have the religious theological aspect of God's ark, God's throne being brought and representing his presence. And David says, I have this palace, I have a house, and God is living in a tent. I think I should make God a house. He wants to build God a temple. And Nathan gives him an opinion. He doesn't give him the word of God. He says, yeah, you know, what's in your heart is good. Go ahead and do that. And then God stops Nathan and says, no, no, no. Go tell David this instead. And the message of this is really, David, you're not going to build me a house. I'm going to build you a house or a dynasty. It's a play on words there. You could go through chapter 7, and you could highlight or write down all the verses that talk about house, because house comes up over and over again here, and in that repetition of the word is really important. And so the kingdom is so essential. The 2 Samuel focuses on the kingdom, and the same events in Chronicles focus more on the temple. What's focused on here, the kingdom, is necessary. And it supersedes even the building of the temple. God said, look, I've always lived in a tent. From Egypt until now, I've always lived in a tent. I've never asked for a house to be built for me. He goes, that's going to happen. But the primary thing, the priority, the central thing, David, is first, I need to build you a house and I need to build you a kingdom before your kingdom builds me a house. So you see what God is getting at here. He's saying, David, that your house is going to be the mechanism by which God accomplishes his plan on the earth. And he says that in a sense, is of a place of primary importance. And so he places that first. And so when he talks about here, the house, I think we know what this means, but he's not talking about building David a literal house. I mentioned building him a dynasty. But when we speak, we use this language even now. In the monarchy in England is the House of Windsor. And so this is using similar language. It's all the other kings are going to be the House of David. And when I had my discussion with my friend earlier this week about Judges, I said, well, Dave, you know, this is all accomplished through the Davidic covenant and the Davidic kings. And I said, so and he goes, well, yeah, but that was a promise to David and to Solomon and also applied to Christ. I'm like, but all the kings of Israel are Davidic kings after this point. There's no other king who's not in David's line. I said, so it all has to do with the Davidic king. So, but anyway, so that's what is being set up here, is David's house is being built for him. And it's going to be through the house of David that the promises of God are going to be accomplished. So God promises a king or a second Adam in Genesis 3:15 that would crush the head of the serpent, and that he is going to restore that dominion over creation and that rule over creation that's prominent in Genesis 1. Subdue the earth and all that. And then that's brought down to Abraham, and Abraham's promised the nation as well, and it's going to be through Israel. Now it's in Genesis 49, narrows it down to the line of Judah, which is going to be the kingly line. The scepter will not depart from your house. Now it gets narrowed down even further to the line of David and to the individual of the Davidic king. This is the role that the Davidic king has to fulfill, that the plans of God are going to be accomplished through him. And this is, again, not a perfect analogy, but I watched that movie with Bill Murray, Groundhog Day, this week. The point of that movie, and I kind of have a love-hate relationship with that movie because I think Bill Murray's really funny, but that movie, it's the point of the movie is that it repeats the day over and over again. But basically, it repeats the day over and over again until he gets it right, is the main point. So, but it made me think about this, and in a limited sense, Israel is going to keep going through this cycle of obedience and disobedience, and the kings are going to keep failing until one king finally gets it right. And that's what David starts looking forward to and starts realizing is that, and you see this in the Psalms, you see this in the life of Solomon, you see that a lot of the kings, some of them get a lot of things right. Solomon gets a lot of things right. David gets a lot of things right. Josiah, Hezekiah, a lot of good kings. Do a lot of things right, and then they have their failures that kind of don't allow them to fully accomplish that. They're sinners, and then there are some really bad kings, Ahab and Manasseh, and some kings that will say they're the worst, worst kings. Jeconiah, yeah, and he brings a whole curse. He's so bad he brings his own, he gets his own individual curse that says no more from this house. And so that's a tension that's resolved in Christ as well, because he has to avoid that curse, so he can't be born from that line. So that's what another reason why the genealogies are important. So he promises to build David a house. The next one, this is hugely important, verse 12. Is the seed. He says, when your days are complete and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your descendant after you who will come forth from you, and I will establish his kingdom. I read the word as descendant that time, but it's better, and you want to be careful with words. You want to make sure that the same word being used is interpreted the same, but is also trying to every time the word, you don't want to get too carried away. It's like, oh, this passage uses the word the, and that's from in the beginning, or something like that. But sometimes there are specific words and sentences and structures used that are meant to trigger your mind to understand certain things. Like if I said, I mentioned this last week, if I started saying, for God so loved the world, and I didn't finish, John 3:16, but started talking about something else, you would understand I brought your mind to John 3:16 so that I could talk kind of in that context. Or if I said, we the people, and I, start talking about, American government or something, you would understand I referenced the Constitution, or, and so that's often what Scripture does. It builds on previous revelation and uses specific words, and the prophets here are exegetes. They're taking words, they're theologians, they're taking concepts, and they're building on them, and then under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, they're projecting forward. What is God going to have to do because he's made these promises? How's God going to work out his plan in history? So part of the historical process of revelation is not magical. Remember that men are writing these words, but they're careful readers of the Bible. And they're reading it in a way that we can learn from and follow their pattern. And yes, they are unique in the sense that the Holy Spirit's providing new revelation through them. But they set up, you know, patterns here. But my point is, the word descended, it's helpful in I would say most cases to say seed, because that refers to, you know, an idea that starts in Genesis and works its way through the Old Testament, through the New Testament, and connects together so many different ideas. So, but what David is promised here, when your days are complete, so now he's saying, now we're ending the promises directly for you that will apply to the future, and we're going to talk about when your days are complete, what's going to happen beyond this that God is going to work. And he promises David a seed. And this doesn't just mean one individual. It can mean Solomon, but it also means the line of Davidic kings, and it also refers in long term and ultimately to Christ. But it's reaching back to the seed of the woman, Genesis 3:15, that she's promised a seed who would crush the head of the serpent. And then in Genesis 4:1, she has Cain and names him Cain, which means I've got you. Is this the Lord has given me a son? And so she's probably thinking there, well, maybe my son is going to be the one who's going to fix things. Obviously, she's disappointed in that because it's Cain and Abel. And that's what the hope is through Noah. Maybe this is the one who will give us rest. And then it comes to Abraham. Abraham is also promised land and blessing to the nations, but through his seed, the seed that's going to be the nation of Israel. And then in Genesis 22:18, after he sacrifices Isaac, or is intending to sacrifice Isaac, and the Lord stops him, he says, your seed will, you know, receive these promises. Paul picks up on this language in Galatians and talks about, he doesn't refer to seeds as to many, but to seed, singular, as to one, which is Christ. And Paul, if you're following where Paul is going, you're seeing that Paul is using a specific word. He's using the grammar of a specific text in a very careful way, and he's saying he's building on Scripture and interpreting it rightly. And so what David is promised here is a continual seed to take his throne. And so this is what he is offered here, what God will accomplish through him, and that his kingdom will be established forever. And so this refers in a way to Solomon. Solomon is his son. It is his seed who comes about after him. He comes forth from him, and he does establish his kingdom. And Solomon, for all his failures, does get really close. There is creational language even in what Solomon is able to accomplish. The nations start coming. The Queen of Sheba starts coming to him. They start interacting with Israel. Israel is raised to this place of its height militarily and as far as trade and all these things. But Solomon starts not following the law of the kings and starts multiplying gold and wives and military might, and you know, and then the kingdom splits after him. It never gets to that height again. So, and Solomon's a temple builder, and he builds a temple, which we'll talk about in just a second. But so Solomon is that seed in a sense, but even Solomon and David recognize that this is not, that Solomon's not the one. He's not going to be the one that totally accomplishes it. We see the potential in all that Solomon's able to do. For how this might be worked out, but he's not able to bring it together. He's not able to complete the mission of the Davidic king. And so God disciplines him, and he disciplines his son. Let's look at verse 13. One more thing in verse 12. There's another quote from Genesis. Abraham was promised a son from his own body. David is now promised the same thing with this seed, who will come forth from you, from your own body, in a sense, is what is being picked up on here. Now, for Abraham, that was miraculous because he, you know, it says his body was as good as dead. But it's from him, and he goes, okay, well, maybe it's not for me and Sarah, maybe it's for me and Hagar. And he tries to do things his own way, and David's like, and God's like, no, That's not what I'm saying. You're going to have one from you and Sarah. Okay, and then, you know, then Abraham has faith and that produces Isaac, and continues that line. But that is what is being picked up on here. It pulls in from the language from Abraham and the theology from Abraham. Now David's going to have a son from his own body who's going to continue on, take up and continue on the promises there. But let's look at verse 13, which is the temple. The promise of that the seed will build the temple. It says, he shall build a house for my name. And goes on there to talk about his throne and his kingdom. But the seed will be a temple builder. David would not build a temple for the Lord, but the Lord would build a house for David so that the seed of David could build a house for the Lord. It kind of completes that circle there. And this is accomplished in Solomon. Solomon does build the temple. And Solomon's temple becomes that center of God's worship. And then there comes a point where it's destroyed, and it comes a point where it's rebuilt. And the temple is such a key concept in Scripture. Chronicles, you know, really focuses in on the temple. Ezekiel focuses in on God's temple on wheels, in a sense, coming in and, you know, showing what God's true temple. The temple is rebuilt toward the end of the Old Testament. But the thing is, with the temple being rebuilt, is that Haggai talks about that the Lord's presence is not there in the same way that it was with the original temple. Meaning that they're still in exile. They have still, even though they're in the land, even though they have the temple, that the Lord's presence has not returned in the same way, and would not until they are delivered from exile. And so that they are still in this position, even though they have a land in which they're dwelling, and even though there is a Solomon's temple, it's not the completion of what God has for the plan of Israel. So Solomon does fulfill this in a way, that the seed does build the temple, but it's not, you know, it's not completed. The point here, the greater point, is that the king in relation to the temple is that David's son is going to have to be a temple builder. He's going to have to build and restore the true temple of God. Now we see, you know, maybe we pick up some connections to the New Testament. One of the first things Jesus does in John, you know, John chapter 2, is he goes in and he cleanses the temple. And people have used this, I myself have even used this, I think, somewhat incorrectly to say that, you know, there's times where you should have righteous anger for truth and God's word, and that is a true principle. But this text is uniquely showing that Jesus, as the one who is able to build the temple, has that authority as that, not only the Son of God, but the Son of David. He comes in and cleanses out the temple, gets everybody out of the temple, and he says, stop making my Father's house a marketplace. And then the apostles, the disciples, look at Jesus at the time, and they remember a Davidic psalm. They remember Psalm 69, which is written by David, and they remember, zeal for your house will consume me, that will be such a part of the ultimate, you know, what the king, Davidic king should be, that he should be so concerned with the glory of God and the honor of God's house and God's worship and God's presence, that zeal for the house of God has eaten me up. And they think about this and they say, they're seeing Jesus as, okay, maybe this is the true David. This is the true king. And they're quoting Psalm 69:9 there. And Jesus then, as he's confronted by the leaders, he's saying, what sign are you going to give us that you're able to do this? And he says, tear down this temple, referring to his own body. And they're like, well, this temple took 46 years to build. And he says, you know, and John makes an editorial note there and says, but the temple he was referring to was not that temple. He was referring to his body, so that after he was resurrected, they would remember that he said this. And so that's what Jesus is saying, in a sense. Now, not only am I here to cleanse out and restore what the temple is meant to be about, and he begins and ends his ministry with doing that, but he's saying, in a sense, that he's the true temple. That this goes back to even Genesis, John 1, where he talks about that Nathan comes to him and says that, you're the king of Israel, or maybe it's Philip, comes in and says, you're the son of God, you're the king of Israel. And Jesus says, have you believed because I told you you're under the fig tree? He says, well, you're going to see more amazing things than that. You're going to see angels ascending and descending the Son of Man, which is a quote from Genesis 28, when Jacob sees this ladder, this staircase between heaven and earth, and sees angels ascending and descending on this ladder. And Jesus is saying, and then Jacob names that place House of God. Jesus is saying, now I'm coming. Now we're going to have the real House of God. We're going to have that real connection between heaven and earth. And Jesus is stepping into that role. And so imagine then Jesus being in that role as the Davidic son and the temple builder in Matthew 24 and Luke and Mark 13 and also in Luke, when they're looking at the temple and they're like, look how great this temple is. Look at all the stones, look at all the gold. And Jesus says, this whole thing is coming down. It's going to be torn down. Not one stone is going to be left upon another. It's going to be totally unrecognizable, which gets fulfilled about 40 years after Christ in 70 AD. The whole thing is torn apart. And this gives us some context into the New Testament identity of the church and what we're meant to be when it talks about you are a temple. Do you not know that you are a temple and the Spirit of God dwells in you? Christ has built his people to be a representation of that temple. Not with stones anymore, but he says, I built you up in 1 Peter with living stones. Now you're living stones in a living temple that's meant to represent the presence of God among you. Ephesians 2, that you're of the household of God, fellow citizens with the saints, all this stuff. You've been brought in and you're laid on the foundation of apostles and prophets, and now you're being built up into a house, a dwelling place, a temple for God. And in Revelation 21, at the end of the Bible, when it says that the New Jerusalem comes down, and it says something's missing in it. I saw no temple, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. God is perfectly with his people at that point. And so the idea of a temple and Christ being the temple builder is true. And there is going to come a point on this earth where there's going to be a temple built. Christ is going to return and there's going to be a true temple built in Jerusalem. But we reflect that's coming. We're God's house. We're God's temple. Our bodies are the temple. We gather as the church, as a type of the temple that is coming. And Christ has built that, and is building that in the world. And that's our identity. What we show to the world.
Living stones.
Yeah, we're living stones. Being built up. So that's great imagery. That's something you can. We can take with us even as we go out here and worship. It's at the had a conversation with a former student in Christian Club who's at college now, and he was asking just about the nature of the church. They used to meet in houses, now they meet in churches. What's the deal with that? And I had to explain, the church is not the building, it's the people. And we who have been around biblical teaching understand that, but we should hear ourselves say it again. The church is the people who are here, who are in Christ, who are being ruled by the word of Christ, who are worshiping Christ, who are in the presence of the Holy Spirit. This is a unique time of what we get to do in worshiping together. And it's meant to be unique, and it's meant to be a sign to the rest of the world and to Israel of what is still coming. Got a couple minutes. Let me finish up here in just a couple minutes. But the next thing is promised is an eternal throne or an eternal kingdom. It says, I'll establish his kingdom, verse 12, and in verse 13, I will establish his throne, the throne of his kingdom forever. And so the kingdom of David was going to be a historical, theological manifestation of the kingdom of God. It was going to be a real kingdom on the ground, on earth, but it also had the theological dimension, which God ruled on the earth through that kingdom. Just like God ruled on the earth originally through Adam on the earth. It's going to be through David. Write down Psalm 61. We won't have time to get to it today, but Psalm 61. David, the hope that David starts to look forward to is the hope that we look backward to in Christ. David starts to see that God's going to set up this eternal king, that God's going to set up this eternal kingdom, and he's going to add days to this king's life, and that this king is going to be able to accomplish all that is here in the Davidic covenant, that he will abide before God forever, as it says in Psalm 61:7. And so David starts to look ahead to the ultimate fulfillment of this hope, that's our connection with David. We're not David in this story. We're not David in the story of David and Goliath. We're not David in the story of David and Bathsheba. We can draw some principles for sure, but the point is, David looked to and rested in the same hope of his coming seed. We look back and rest in that same hope of his coming seed, what Christ has accomplished as a Davidic king, and what he's going to accomplish in the world. And so we rest in the same promises. We rest in the same hope. The other thing, verse 14 that is promised, is a sonship or adoption. I will be a father to him, and he will be a son to me. So the Davidic kings would have a unique father-son relationship to the Lord. They would not only be sons of David, but they'd be sons of God, in a sense. They would be, the Davidic king would take up the role of Adam, who's the original son of God, it refers to that in Luke 3, and Israel, Exodus 4:22, God, through Moses to Pharaoh, says, Israel is my son, my firstborn. And now it's being brought down to an individual. The Davidic king is the son. Psalm 2, you are my son, today I have begotten you. And this is applied to Christ, so we have to be careful about here, and we'll just end here with this. This is applied to Christ in Hebrews 1:5, rightly, because Christ is a Davidic king. What we have to be careful here is Christ is the Son of God eternally, but he also, as a man, steps into Davidic sonship. Meaning, as a man on the earth, he takes on this role in which it could be said God begets him or adopts him or creates him as the son of God in the Davidic sense. But he's also, Romans 1, 3, and 4, he's the eternal son of God, or John 5, 18. He shares the same nature as the Father. So he's the true son of God, but he's the son of God in a couple different senses. He's the son of God and the eternal son of God in that he shares the same essence of God, but he's also the son of God in that he is the Davidic king. He's the who has that father-son relationship to God as a man on the earth, which he still has and still bears and still has in himself. So this, just to be careful there, because it can lead to some confusion where some people can get confused on, you know, when did Jesus become the Son of God? Was he adopted at some point in, you know, as the Son of God? You know, or was he eternally the Son of God? But what helps is understanding there's different meanings and different roles to that term, Son of God, and we just need to be careful with what is being taught here. I myself, and I don't feel too bad because John MacArthur had this controversy years and years ago where he admitted mistakenly, in his commentary on Hebrews, said that Jesus was always God but became the Son of God, and that's just a little tweak of the language there. And then he was brought to, and he said, I changed my mind. And, that's what smart and humble and godly people do when they're wrong. They're like, oh, this is this is wrong. I changed my mind. I thought that too for a long time until a few years ago. That I was like, because I would read Luke 1:35, and then he will be, you know, he'll be born, and then he shall be called Son of God. I was like, okay, so he's called Son of God because he's born into the world. But then I'm like, oh, well, he's also the eternal Son of God, Romans 1:3. So just important to keep those things in mind. And we'll close there. We haven't looked at a lot of this stuff, but we'll end it there. And go to worship. Some things to think about, you know, the next thing is the promise is that he's going to be disciplined for sin, that he's going to be, which Jesus doesn't have sin, all the other Davidic kings do, and God says, I'm going to not reject them, I'm going to discipline them. But it also takes on the idea that the Davidic king can suffer for sin. Can suffer for sin and be the representative, in a sense, for his people. And that's seen all the way back in Numbers 25 and Deuteronomy 21, 23. He curses everyone who hangs on a tree, that you can punish the leaders for the people, and that the people are identified with their king. And so many of these ideas are tied together. Why the Davidic covenant is important is because all this comes together in Christ, that even the new covenant, which we're very thankful for, we're new covenant believers, we're in the New Testament, is that even the new covenant is accomplished through the Davidic covenant. It's the plan of God for the world is bigger than just us and our salvation, though that is central. It is a larger picture that Christ died and bought a kingdom and purchased the world. And he is the king of the world who reigns. And it's our job to recognize that and to proclaim that. So let's go to prayer and then go to worship and worship our King. Lord God, we thank you for this time to look more deeply into your word. Lord, there's so much here. There's so much truth. We pray that this would not just help us understand the scriptures that we go through, I think even this morning in Acts, that apply so many of these truths, but that it would lead us to understanding who you are in our worship, and it would lead us to understanding who we are in our identity and our mission and our purpose in the world, that we can show that Christ is King and that he reigns and that he reigns over us and that we are that temple that has been built by Christ to show the truth that he is the true temple builder, that your spirit dwells here. So we ask, Lord, that you would help us to go into worship this morning with a sense of anticipation for what you will do, that we will not just sit there and be passive, but that we will be active participants in the worship of your Son. Lord, it's in his name we pray. Amen.